Welcome back, my dear viewers. In today's video, let's leap into one of the fundamental concepts of networking, which is nothing but virtual LANs. In order to explain the virtual LAN concept, I'm just displaying a simple and little network, which literally contains a couple of devices in it. By default, all the switch ports present in the access switch in same VLAN is nothing but default VLAN, VLAN number 1. So any device can able to communicate to any other device in the network, which may looks easier, but there are a lot of security issues to allowing it in enterprise environment. In simple words, I don't want the sales and the production systems communicates. This is where the guy VLAN comes in. By default, with access switches, we cannot achieve that. We need to do some configuration changes, some modifications in every access switch. By using the virtual LAN, we can able to group the set of devices logically, though those devices separated physically. In order to group the devices logically, let me say, I can create a virtual LAN in both those access switches and simply tag these switch ports into the virtual LAN in order to group these two endpoints. Let's go and create the VLAN. As I told earlier, all the switch ports by default will be in its default VLAN. So we are going to make one virtual LAN. The command is very simple, it's VLAN, and I'm going to create VLAN number 2. So I'm in the VLAN configuration mode. I'm naming the VLAN, so I'm creating for one of my departments. Now the VLAN creation is done. Now the VLAN has been created. You can verify it. Been created. Now I need to move this fast Ethernet 0/1 and fast Ethernet 0/1 in the access switch 2 both in the same VLAN. In order to do that, I need to get into the interface configuration mode. To put the particular switch port in the VLAN, the command is switch port mode access. Access is one of the switch port modes. If we put a switch port in access mode, then we can configure specific VLAN for the switch port. Switch port access VLAN, and I am giving the VLAN number 2. Now I have added this fast Ethernet 0/1 into the VLAN 2. I can verify it. Now the switch port has been added into the created virtual LAN. Like we did in access switch 1, we have to do the same in access switch 2. I did the same kind of configuration in my access switch 2 also. Now let me configure different VLAN for these two devices. After finishing the configuration, it will look like this. Now I created different VLANs and I put the switch ports in that VLAN. Let me try to ping the devices within the same VLAN. Let's see whether it will work or both the devices are in the same VLAN, but still it is not working. Do you have any idea? Do you know why it is happening? So far it is focused only on the switch port which is connecting to the endpoints. We haven't focused on the links which is connecting the switches. Let me give a scenario. In this case, I am going to transfer two kind of traffic, two VLAN traffic into the same link. I want to use the sales system also to use the same link, also the production systems to use the same link. In this case, we cannot use one particular VLAN in this switch ports. This is where we need to use another switch port mode, which is called trunk mode. If we put this switch port GIG 0/1 in both the switches in trunk mode, then the trunk mode will be able to carry the traffic of both the VLANs. Briefly saying, no matter how many VLANs are present in your network, the trunk link can able to carry the traffic of all those VLANs. Let's do it. I am access switch 1. Same command, switch port mode, but instead of access, I am giving trunk mode. So I am ordering the switch port to take the trunk mode. Now it is in trunk mode. We can simply verify whether one particular switch port is in trunk mode or access mode. Since the trunk mode is not belongs to one particular VLAN, after we adding the switch port in the trunk mode, it will be disappeared from this VLAN database. There is no GIG 0/1 interface in this database, which represents that particular interface is not in access mode. It is in trunk mode. Also, I'll tell you one more command. Show interfaces trunk. It will show you the switch port which is present in the trunk mode. The status is trunking. To make this link to carry all VLAN traffic, we have to put both switch 1 and switch 2's GIG interfaces in trunk mode. It's done in access switch 2. Now let me check the same. You can see earlier it was not able to reach the device. Now it can, because this link carries the traffic of both the VLANs. Also, let me try this. Now, a question may arise. How these two switches identify the traffic which is flowing through this trunk link is belongs to which VLAN? Your query, your doubt is 10% correct. It's a valid one. Let me clarify it. I am in simulation mode. Do the same. Let's see this particular frame.
it is getting into the switch. When it is leaving, note on this keyword DOT1Q header. The outgoing port is trunk port and the incoming port VLAN number is allowed in the trunk, which sends out the frame to the port. Also, note on this layer 3 PDU and the Ethernet frame. Simply, it is having the destination MAC address and the source MAC address, and the type, the data, and the FCS check. If you see this outgoing frame, there will be some additional fields, which is nothing but the VLAN information has been added in the frame. When an access switch prepares to send a frame into the trunk link, before sending, it will add some header information with its VLAN number. So, and it simply passes the frame through the trunk link. So, the receiver, the access switch, when it receives the frame, it will open and reads this particular VLAN information and it will get to know that frame belongs to which VLAN. And it will send the traffic to the respective device. When the switch analyzes the inbound PDU, it will get to know this frame belongs to VLAN 2. Then it simply forwards the frame to the particular destination. So whenever we connect two switches together, typically we used to have the trunk link in between, which is used to carry the traffic of multiple VLANs. Also, by default, if you configure one link as a trunk, by default it carries all of its VLANs traffic. All the VLANs have been allowed through the trunk. As I told earlier, the access switch, before sending the frame into the trunk link, it simply encapsulates. Further, it uses the 802.1Q protocol, which was defined by the IEEE. To add the additional security, instead of adding all the VLANs into the trunk mode, we can restrict what are all the VLANs to be passed through one particular trunk link. In order to configure that, get into the same interface configuration mode. Switch port, trunk, then you can set what are all the VLANs are allowed. Here we can define the VLAN number. So when we define the VLAN number here, the particular VLANs will be allowed through the trunk, rest of the VLANs will be denied. In my example, I gave how to configure the trunk in a switch port statically. Instead of doing it statically, we can also configure the dynamic trunking. The little difference in the configuration you can see the third option, dynamic. So if you get into that option, there are two types, auto and desirable. So by default, all the switch ports present in a switch will be in auto mode. Dynamic trunking is nothing but both the switches can negotiate and it can form the trunk itself without manual intervention. But for that, we need to put those interfaces in appropriate modes. If the switch port is in auto mode, then which means that switch port is ready to accept the trunk. But while negotiation, someone has to initiate the trunking. If we configure disableable in one side of the switch, then it will be the initiator for the trunk negotiation. So we can validate it by using one command. So show interfaces gig, the particular interface name and switch port. It will display the details of its negotiation, its encapsulation. It displays everything. The switch port is enabled, the administrative mode is dynamic disableable, so it can initiate the negotiation. And the operational mode is trunk and the encapsulation is DOT1Q. So which is the commonly used encapsulation mode nowadays? Earlier there was a Cisco proprietary encapsulation method called DSL, but nowadays most of the Cisco devices also using the IEEE defined DOT1Q encapsulation method, and the negotiation of trunking is on. In default conditions, both the switch ports in auto trunk mode, so no one will initiate the negotiation. Each will be waiting for someone to initiate the trunk negotiation, so the trunk will not be formed. If you do a modification in one of the switch ports and make it as either disableable or trunk, then the trunk will be formed because the particular switch port will initiate the trunk negotiation, and obviously the trunk will be formed. And in order to form this trunk, there is a protocol called DTP, Dynamic Trunking Protocol, which is used to form the trunk links dynamically. So we can use the keyword no negotiate in order to deny the trunk formation. Now I am giving no negotiate. Switch port no negotiate. Currently it is not accepting because I enabled the dynamic auto trunk mode. Let me change that. I am manually configuring the trunk now. Now I can disable the negotiation. If I validate, I can see the negotiation of trunking is off because I set both the interfaces to establish the trunk statically. So it will be established, but there will be no trunk negotiation dynamically. So the configuration part might look simple, but it has vast usage in the networking. I believe you learned something from this video. If yes, you can consider liking this video and subscribing my channel. Don't forget to click the bell icon so whenever I'm posting the video, you'll get notified. Thank you guys. Thanks for watching. Take care of yourself. See you.